When the king heard the name of Heracles, he would not let him strive in the contest any more. For the maiden Iole would not be given as prize to one who had been mad, and whose madness might afflict him again. So the king said, speaking in judgment in the marketplace. Rage came on Heracles when he heard this judgment given. He would not let his rage master him, lest the madness that was spoken of should come with his rage. So he left the city of Oechalia, declaring to the king and the people that he would return. It was then that, wandering down to Crete, he heard of the Argonauts being near, and afterward he heard of them being in Calydon, hunting the boar that ravaged Aeneas' country. To Calydon Heracles went. The heroes had departed when he came into the country, and all the city was in grief for the deaths of Prince Meleagrus and his two uncles. On the steps of the temple where Meleagrus and his uncles had been brought, Heracles saw Dianara, Meleagrus' sister. She was pale with her grief, this tall woman of the mountains. She looked like a priestess, but also like a woman who could cheer camps of men with her counsel, her bravery, and her good companionship. Her hair was very dark, and she had dark eyes. Straightway, she became friends with Heracles, and Heracles forgot Iole, the childlike maiden whom he had seen in Oechalia. He made himself a suitor for Dianara, and those who protected her were glad of Heracles' suit, and they told him they would give him the maiden to marry as soon as the mourning for Prince Meleagrus and his uncles was over. Heracles stayed in Calydon, happy with Dianara, who had so much beauty, wisdom, and bravery. But then a dreadful thing happened in Calydon. By an accident, while using his strength unthinkingly, Heracles killed a lad who was related to Dianara. He might not marry her now until he had taken punishment for slaying one who was close to her in blood. As a punishment for the slaying, it was judged that Heracles should be sold into slavery for 3 years. At the end of his 3 years' slavery, he could come back to Calydon and wed Dianara. And so Heracles and Dianara were parted. He was sold as a slave in Lydia. The one who bought him was a woman, a widow, named Omphale. To her house Heracles went, carrying his armor and wearing his lion skin. And Omphale laughed to see this tall man dressed in a lion skin coming to her house to do a servant's tasks for her. She and all in her house kept up fun with Heracles. They would set him to do housework, to carry water, and set vessels on the tables, and clear the vessels away. Omphale set him to spin with a spindle, as the women did. And often she would put on Heracles' lion skin and go about dragging his club, while he, dressed in woman's garb, washed dishes and emptied pots. But he would lose patience with these servants' tasks, and then Omphale would let him go away and perform some great exploit. Often he went on long journeys and stayed away for long times. It was while he was in slavery to Omphale that he liberated Theseus from the dungeon in which he was held with Peirithous. And it was while he still was in slavery that he made his journey to Troy. At Troy, he helped to repair for King Laomedon the great walls that years before Apollo and Poseidon had built around the city. As a reward for this labor, he was offered the princess Hesione in marriage. She was the daughter of King Laomedon and the sister of Priam. He helped to repair the wall, and two of the Argonauts were there to aid him. One was Peleus, and the other was Telamon. Peleus did not stay for long. Telamon stayed, and to reward Telamon, Heracles withdrew his own claim for the hand of the princess Hesione. It was not hard on Heracles to do this, for his thoughts were ever upon Dianara. But Telamon rejoiced, for he loved Hesione greatly. On the day they married, Heracles showed the two an eagle in the sky. He said it was sent as an omen to them, an omen for their marriage. And in memory of that omen, Telamon named his son Aias, that is, eagle.